We are live now. So, good evening, esteemed
Madam,
faculty members and all the delegates. Thank you for joining. This is Sahithi on behalf of Shield Connect, welcoming you all for today's webinar on World Cancer Day, organized by TNFOG. So, it's my privilege to introduce the MOC of today's webinar, Dr. Radhika Gauri ma'am. Ma'am has done a specialization in specialist consultant in OBG and clinical lead ESIC Hospital, Tirunelveli, Tamil Nadu. I welcome you, ma'am, and I hand over the session to you.
good evening, everybody. All the esteemed faculties, my teachers, we are going to start this program on behalf of TNFOG for the World Cancer Day. So let us start the program now without any further delay. So first, we are starting with the Kadavul Vaazhthu, Tamil Thai Vaazhthu. Good evening, everybody. So on this day of we have a Cancer Day webinar on behalf of TNFOG, World Cancer Day celebration. So we are I invite Dr. Revathi Janakiraman ma'am to welcome our chief guest, Rishikesh Pai sir.
I'll welcome first and then we can see. Okay.
Okay.
See, can I see? Good evening all and welcome every one of you. And I think this is the last webinar as TNFOG president I am presiding. And of course, I will continue to be a part of it and do actively work for TNFOG in future also. And I recall last year, the same day, we conducted a very, very big mega screening camp at Pedasandur, Dindigul, where all our society members participated. And today we have got a very interesting webinar on cancer screening as well as vaccination. And I welcome our beloved past FOCI president, Dr. Rishikesh Pai, and also Dr. I'll introduce little later. Okay. And also other chief guest, Dr. Ashok Kumar, and speakers as well as delegates. And one thing very heartening is that recently in the interim budget, our finance minister has announced that this HPV vaccination is going to be taken up by the government immediately and vaccinating the 9 to 14 years. And it is going to be taken up in the IAP immunization schedule also. It's really very, very nice to hear that. And I welcome Dr. Rishikesh Pai. Rishikesh Pai sir's CV, please. Very, very vibrant. Can't forget it, this period we worked with him. And he is immediate past president FOCSI, founder and medical director of Bloom IVF Group, chief administrator of FOCSI Manyata project, in which Chetan Refugee also has joined and doing a lot of work on that. And to his credit, he has got a lot of awards and achievements. He has received more than 50 or 60 awards, including the Andre FOCSI Refugee Fellowship. And he has delivered thousands of lectures. And he was president, past secretary general, senior vice president, and secretary general, treasurer, chairman of FOCSI. All posts, I think he has occupied. And next is only FIGO waiting. And honorary consultant of Baba Municipal General Hospital and founder editor of IAGE Journal of, that is JGE.
Dr. Revati, enough. So, thanks for calling me. Actually, na, this is one of my first meetings after the president. I thought I was forgotten. You know how it is. Life is very, very...
How can we
but,
forget you?
But the Twin FOG has remembered me. So, I am at the ISAR conference now at present in Bhubaneswar. And, you know, actually, I was president of ISAR in 2014. So, I should not be sitting here. I should be sitting in ashram in Banaras. But I have this love for the profession. So, I keep on coming. So, Dr. Revati, the president, Dr. Sampath Kumari, our secretary of TNFOG, Dr. Vijaya Lakshmi, our treasurer, then our Dr. Ashok Kumar, who is a dynamic vice chair elect of ICOG, and one day will become ICOG chair, I'm sure he will. And then Dr. Sumati, Dr. Ramani, and Dr. Ramani Devi, Dr. Rajeshwari, Dr. Santi, and Dr. Radhika. I am really grateful to all of you. And I hope I have not missed out on anyone. Dr. Anjalakshmi is also there.
Yeah.
I can see her. And Dr. Santi is there. And so, you know, as you know that I've got a lot of disturbance because a lot of people, you know, in India, everyone loves to talk. So, there's a lot of talking going on in the background. But I'm really happy. And, you know, the CA service has been a very important part of our last year and even this year. And as you know that the government of India has just now sanctioned. I heard that they are buying 7 crore doses. I don't know. Ashok Kumar will know better than me because he knows what happens in PMO's office because he's from Delhi. But whatever, so we have to see that we vaccinate people, we educate them. We have got a lot of grants. We got a grant from the American Cancer Society and Priya Ganesh Kumar and Sampath Kumari, who was the vice president in charge of that committee, have been doing a lot of work, a lot of education. And we also have got a grant from Becton Dickinson, which we have not even started the grant. So, but fortunately, our FOCSI leadership is very good. We have a lot of continuity and we ultimately work for the organization. I remember that during my time, Sampath, we had done a lot of, you remember, cancer survival camps and a lot of, I think one of the Dindigul only, one of those societies that done maximum.
Yes, Dindigul and Madurai.
Yeah, Madurai also had done a lot of work. And so it's a so there are two main challenges which we have. One is on maternal health, obviously. PPH, sepsis and hypertension is and anemia is very important for us. Then the other is cancer cervix. And third, of course, is contraception. And the other new things like mental health, violence against women, gender equality, blah, blah. All these things are there. So it's a very challenging kind of, you know, very exciting for us as gynecologists. We have a fantastic, very exciting kind of life. You know, there's so much to do and so short a time to do it for all of us. But we keep on doing whatever we can in a good faith. And, you know, even as you say, even one drop of work matters in the larger things. You know, everything that we do matters. And we hope that we can create certain change and impact in the world. So I'll not take much of your time. But remember one thing. I was just thinking, and this is very important, this point which I'm making. See, the HPV test or the vaccine for that matter does not block. We have to do the perspeculum examination and pap smear every whatever years and all. The checkup has to be done. It's like the same problem with carbetocin and oxytocin. If you are using carbetocin in your practice, that doesn't mean you don't need oxytocin. You need oxytocin. You have to have the cold chain. You have to have the refrigerator. You cannot do without oxytocin. You can't use carbetocin antenatally. Similarly, you need the speculum examination. You cannot by guarantee say that, achha, I've given this person a vaccine, so she is not going to develop cancer something. No. We have to do. So, it doesn't preclude us from doing a pap smear, or it doesn't preclude us from, this is my opinion. Because even if we miss one patient, and one patient develops cancer, it is not acceptable. You can say, achha, out of 100,000 people, 999 will be protected because give the vaccine, one of them. No. We cannot run away from the responsibility of examining each and every patient of ours every year as a health checkup. And that is not in the mindset of our Indian people. Our challenge is to see that they come to us every year and do that checkup. This is our main challenge. And this vaccination, this whatever type of thing, cannot replace that challenge. That is what my request to all of you. Don't forget that the most important thing is the health checkup every year. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir is in
Bhuneshwar.
These are
contracts.
Anyway, thank you so much, sir.
Okay. And my request is, I'm now preparing for the All India. I need all the important people from all the TNFOG, all from each of the every society, the chair, vice president, the president, the previous past president, some of the important people in your community of each society. I need them, and you must tell them what is the speciality of each, what their talks they are interested in, whom should be made chairs, who should be made panelists, who should be made speaker. I want that information from TNFOG. And Ashok, that you are there here, please, the Delhi society, I need the information from Delhi, whom should be taken and all. Right, all sir. The list I need. Huh? Because we want to finish the scientific program for the All India by maximum by May or June. I want to finish it off. Okay.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sure,
bye-bye.
Done.
Bye.
Done.
Bye.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. We will remember definitely the message from Pai, sir, that we will have to do a speculum examination. Mm-hmm. Clinical examination cannot replace any other process. So we definitely have to follow the guidelines and the clinical examination. And next, we would I'd request Anjalakshi ma'am to invite guest of honor, Dr. Ashok Kumar sir. Dr. Anjalakshi ma'am is a senior consultant from Chennai. She's a founder president of TNFOG and past president of OXI. She's a governing council member of DIPSI, recipient of the Best Doctor Award from IMA. And she's a retired professor, our teacher from Madras Medical College, retired professor HOD of Oxford Gyne Mada Medical College. And madam has presented a number of papers, national and international conferences. Madam, please introduce sir.
Thank you, ma'am. It is my great honor and privilege to introduce Dr. Ashok Kumar, who is the director, professor, and head department of obstetrics and gynecology, Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute of Medical Sciences, Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia Hospital, New Delhi. He is the secretary, Indian College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, 21 to 23, and vice chairperson elect, Indian College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. Dear Dr. Ashok Kumar, I welcome you and kindly bless this seminar.
Thank you, madam. Good evening to all. I am thankful to Tamil Nadu Federation of Obs and Gyne, Dr. Revati Janakirsan, for president of TNFOG, Dr. Ramani Devi, vice president, Dr. Sampath Kumari, secretary, and Dr. Anjalakshmi and all other seniors and office bearers of TNFOG and all the members. I'm thankful to all of you for having me in this webinar on this World Cancer Day. This is a very important day. And now we have a lot of awareness, a lot of publicity about this problem, and cancer cervix is the problem which we are targeting to eliminate or to decrease the incidence in our population. And you know, last year, Minister of Science and Technology had launched the vaccine also, Indian-made vaccine, made in India. And we are fortunate to have this type of vaccine. Now, probably it will be available in the Indian market at a very low price. Maybe the news is coming that between 200 or 300, it will be available. And it will be a boon to our population at that time, whenever it is available. And we are listening that it will be available very soon. And as Madam has also told that our finance minister, Government of India, has also announced in her budget speech also about the concern of this disease and the vaccination also. So now more and more awareness is available. And I may add here that I have also started in our hospital cervical cancer screening center, because we are now doing LBC, liquid based cytology, for all the women, along with
HPV.
HPV testing also. We have HPV kit available with us, and we are combining these two tests. Co-testing is now recommended in our FOCI guideline also, that in a set of population, co-testing should be preferred. And we are doing both the kits, both the testing at our center. And that is why probably it is first center in the Delhi that we are making available to all the patients. Along with, we are guiding, we are teaching, we are making all the patients aware about the vaccination. And we are waiting that as soon as this vaccine is available, we will provide this also free of cost in our government hospital. So we have taken this step in last few months in our, because it is central government hospital, public hospital. So we are all doing this. So I am very happy to be here with you, and the talk on vaccination and about cervical cancer will be beneficial to all the participants of this webinar. And I congratulate Tamil Nadu Federation of Obs and Gynae for taking this initiative on this day of World Cancer Day, where we have to make aware and we have to raise the intensity of this campaign to eliminate cervical cancer. Thank you very much. I may add here that I was very much many times examiner at IOG also, Chennai, Institute of Obstetrics and Gynecology. I think it is a long back. Many times I have been there as a DNB examiner or as a MDMS examiner also. So that was a real attachment to be there with all of you. And thank you very much for having me here. And I congratulate all of you for a very big successful webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We will call you back to IOG again.
All right.
Gauri, Radhika.
Thank you, sir. And HPV. Cancer screening by Dr. Amani ma'am. I the chairpersons. Revati ma'am, who is the former director, IOG Chennai, Vice President FOCI South Zone, now current President TNFOG
2023.
Just two lines.
You can proceed to
the next. Department of Obs and Gynae, MFC. Chennai, 30 years of government service, and she has 25 years of experience in the field of OG, and she is OG and PG teacher for more than 20 years, master trainer in emergency obstetrics, and specially trained in corposcopy, and her area of interest is cancer screening and social obstetrics. Madam Ramani, ma'am Sumati, can you please?
Okay, introduce, no problem. It is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Ramani Rajendran. She is a great, very humble personality, and she has done, I can't say, lot of screening camps, and not only that, she has taught many the screening methods, right from viability to everything, and I can say she is a pioneer, and nobody else can be an apt person to talk on this topic of cancer screening. And she has done a diploma in colposcopy also, And she has presented many papers on cervical pathology, ISCCP. And she has written two chapters on cervix, Bhaskar Chaudhary's text on clinical gynecology. Over to you, madam. We are very eager to hear you about this cancer screening. Something new points we can learn from you even today. Welcome.
Sahiti?
Yes,
please unmute yourself.
Ma'am, kindly unmute. Yes.
Share screen. Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, Ramani.
Madam, is the screen audible?
Yes, we can see.
Nice. My voice is audible.
Both okay.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for TNFOG for giving me this opportunity. Yeah, my sincere thanks to Professor Revati Janakiram, Dr. Sampath Kumari, and Dr. Anjalakshmi, madam, for giving me this opportunity to share my views on cervical cancer screening. So actually the screening test is nothing but to identify a disease in a normally or apparently normal person from those who don't have the disease. So actually this has taken a great setback during the COVID crisis for the past 2 years. And now it's time for us to bounce back to great heights and live up to the expectation of the WHO initiative, which aims to bring down the incidence of cervical cancer from the existing 18 to 19 per lakh to 4 per lakh by 2030. For this, they have almost given like a target that you have to screen, you have to vaccinate 90% of the girls below the age of 15 years. And 70% of the women of the reproductive age group should be screened with a high performance test at least twice in the lifetime. And 90% who have been identified with the disease should have undergone treatment at the appropriate center. So this easy form to remember is GST. GST is now a common word, a common abbreviation that is seen in every time you make any purchase. And so this is the common misnomer. Coming to the contribution of cervical cancer by India, it's around 20%. So the incidence is around 1,23,000 to 24,000 per year. But the screening is very, very low. It is as low as 3%. And by the latest WHO Cancer Cervix Indian profile, it says the screening rate is only up to maximum up to 5%, not more than that. So in this map, you will see a small area that is in blue. Can you make out the small area? Probably this is shaded because we are the pioneers. Tamil Nadu is the pioneers in cervical screening. And that is why we have a place in the map. And we have started as early as 2005. And it is a continuing ongoing program. So for this cancer screening, we have two important guidelines. One is the FOCSI's good clinical practice recommendation. And the other one is the WHO's guidelines that has been published in 2021. This is as my latest is June 2023. Here, the main thing is we have to, the theme of this World Cancer Day is close the care gap. So we have to strictly follow these guidelines. Only then the recommended best practice and the, actually the what the patient gets drastically, it might vary. So this gap has to be adequately followed, adequately sealed, only if you are following these two recommendations. So coming to the methods of cervical screening, the visual inspection of cervix with acetic acid, 5% acetic acid is now used. We are no longer using 3% acetic acid, and the visual inspection of cervix with Lugol's iodine has been given away as a screening modality, but still it's a part of colposcopy. Then you have the cervical cytology, HPV testing, and the colposcopy. So coming to the advantages of VAA, it doesn't require any laboratory infrastructure. It can be performed by any category of health professionals, right? Nurses, midwives, but after a short training period, the consumables are all affordable, easily available in the existing setup. And it is truly a point of care test. The woman is immediately informed about the test outcome. And if it's negative, she is assured and asked to come back after 3 years. Immediate availability of the result makes this as a single visit approach. The sensitivity is almost similar to cytology, especially in a resource limited or low resource settings. And the screening of VAA followed by appropriate management reduces the mortality from cervical cancer as demonstrated in the RC trials. Sorry, madam. Coming to the limitations, every method has got its own drawbacks. The specificity is low. It might lead to unnecessary referrals, over-treatment, and adverse psychological consequences in women when they know the results. And subsequent nature of the demand, because this is a procedure where the trainer must keep on, they must be vigorously trained, and periodic refresher courses are necessary for the providers. See, every 2 years, 3 years, the nurses are being, from the NCD group, are constantly being moved to other departments. So it is very, very important that we impart vigorous training and periodic refresher courses. And it detects lesions only on the ectocervix. So when it comes to postmenopausal lady, it becomes very difficult. Previous cesareans, again, VAA has got a very limited role. And it's highly variable and subjective in nature. Hence, the sensitivity is very low. And moreover, we are not able to document. You are able to write down the notes, but you are not able to document with pictures. So it becomes very, it's, it's very difficult to reproduce the images. So coming to the VAA triage, it can be also done as a part of screening. That is, those who have a primary screening test by HPV positive. If they are found by HPV testing, and if they are found as HPV positive, then they can be triaged by using a VAA, which is a very simple method. So this is, again, when you primary test is positive, single test is positive, then you treat, it is screen and treat. When you triage the patient with a second test, either it can be VAA, it can be colposcopy or cytology, then we call it as screen, triage and treat. The current status in India is, because of limited resources, we have to continue with VAA. And it will be continuing as a primary modality of screening till we have enough resources to introduce HPV detection tests regularly. So it is, as of now, it is only VAA. But the WHO recommends using HPV DNA as a primary screening test. So this is because it has got a high sensitivity rate, 100% negative predictive value. It's very accurate. If HPV is positive, they can undergo treatment at the same visit. So these two are the approaches recommended by WHO. In one, we have the screen and treat. We only have the treatment is based on a positive primary screening test. Screen, triage, and treat is you have a positive primary test followed by a second test that is also positive, but that doesn't, you need not have a histological confirmed diagnosis. So this is the recommendation by FOCI. In good resources, think where you have all the facilities, then do the HPV DNA testing. And the other thing that is acceptable is cytology. In the low resource setting, if possible, do the HPV testing. If not, go for VIA between the age group of 30 to 65. So primary screening, again, they have given the algorithm for both VIA and HPV DNA. So this, when you put in a speculum, you are able to see the cervix completely. The cervix is looking at you. You are able to map the entire new squamous columnar junction. And we say this cervix is adequate for visualization. New SCG seen completely, type 1 TZ. There is, on the transformation zone, a lesion extending from almost 5 o'clock to 9 o'clock. 9 o'clock. So the entire lesion is on the ectocervix. And this is suitable for ablative methods of treatment, both cryo and the thermal ablation. Coming into another cervix, here you have a dense aceto-white lesion with straight borders encroaching into the endocervical canal. This is also within the transformation zone. So here, we will not be able to do an ablative treatment. Here, she needs an excisional form of treatment, either LETS or a cone biopsy. So when the cervix is replaced by a growth, she needs a biopsy for confirmation, for tissue diagnosis, and referral to the cancer department. So cytology has been the mainstay since 1925. It has made a great effort in reducing the incidence of cancers in the well highly developed countries like UK, Europe, USA. It is still the screening test for choice in some countries. But slowly, most of them are switching over to HPV DNA. The cytology, the main drawback is you need a good laboratory infrastructure, well-trained technician, pathologists, and cytopathologists to ensure quality control at all levels. The sensitivity is low. That again depends upon the quality assurance. The test is subjective. The quality depends upon the training and expertise of the cytotechnicians and the pathologists. The results are not available immediately. It may be delayed for a few weeks, or even that depends on the area, on the hospital. And patient with an abnormal cytological report needs to be evaluated with a colposcopy to confirm abnormalities, and colposcopic services, when they are scarce in any resource limited countries, this again, it adds to the burden of the colposcopy. Screen positive women need to make multiple visits to the diagnostic confirmation and treatment. Coming to LBC, here you have this smear as a monolayer using automated machines. So it's monolayer plus devoid of all blood, mucus, and other debris, so that you have a very clear view of the cells, the cytoplasm. So there is an improved fixation, staining, so improved quality and better readability of the slides. Drastically reduces the rate of unsatisfactory smears. The residual material can be used for HPV and other molecular biomarkers. And co-testing increases the detection rate of CIN2 plus, needs specific high-cost equipments and consumables. Manual LBC is less expensive and it's a good alternative to low-resource settings. And we also have a computer-aided cytology to read these LBC slides. But the Bethesda system is used for reporting. But you need to have a good quality assurance system in place. So this is a picture of the of negative intraepithelial lesions or malignancy. The cervix is a normal cervix. So here the cervix is a torn cervix, bilaterally torn, bilateral tear of the cervix present. But there are no lesions with acetic acid and leukoxidin. So this is the usual Bethesda system that is used for the LBC. When it comes to ASCUS, atypical squamous cells of undetermined significance, it is always better that you do an HPV test for triage. If positive, you have to do a colpo. When it comes to H, as atypical squamous cells, H, it means it should be probably because of a high-grade lesion caused by an oncogenic HPV. So HPV testing is mandatory, followed by colposcopy, directed biopsy, and if possible, an endocervical curette. So this is again a low-grade lesion where you find the abnormalities. Only the presence of choelocytes, binucleation in the lower one-third. And on colposcopy, the lesions appear as, here in this, you have small satellite lesions. They are multiple. This has been focused on the anterior lip. And there are two or three on the posterior lip as well. So such patients can be observed if they are around, say 30, 32 for 6 months and see if they regress or completely disappear. Because 90% of these such low-grade lesions would disappear within 6 months to 1 year. But here you have a lesion that is faint aceto white, totally iodine negative. And depending upon the age, if you have it in a younger age group, 30 years, you can wait. If she is around 40 years, you need to do a biopsy and treat her according to the histopathology report. This is again of HSIL. So here you have a lesion, cervix adequate for visualization, new SCG seen completely. Type 1 TZ. Here you have a lesion on the anterior lip, posterior lip, and on at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock version. This lesion is totally iodine negative. They occupy more, almost more 2 to 3 quadrants of the cervix. This is again a dense aceto white patch. Can you see the atypical blood vessels? They are actually like a pointer saying don't miss these lesions, and totally iodine negative. In such lesions where the new squamous columnar junction is not visible and it's a type 3 transformation zone, an excisional biopsy would be more informative to rule out endocervical or glandular lesions. You put in a speculum, you see a cauliflower-like growth. Then a biopsy confirms it is a squamous cell carcinoma. At times, you might come across such cervix where the patient had excessive mucus discharge. On speculum examination, the cervix looks congested. It was thought as a it was described as a large ectopy, but when you add acetic acid, It became intense white, and there were patchy white and red areas, probably suspicious of glandular carcinoma. A biopsy would confirm the same. So coming to the HPVs, they are classified, there are about 100 that types that infect the humans, of which they are classified into low risk and high risk. And 13 of them are considered to be high risk, of which 16 and 18 are responsible for about 70 to 80% of the cervical cancers. They are detected using a DNA detection test, which could be a hybrid capture or the PCR. But these assays only tell you that they are detected or not detected, but they don't specify which type is present or absent. For that, you need to do a special genotyping in which you will get the result as 16 positive, 18 not detected. So specifically, you have to do the genotyping. If you want to go one step further, and you will have to do the mRNA test. This is a potential marker for identification of women at the risk of developing cervical cancer. So this has got a specificity of around 99%. All about HPV is a little costly. Now it has been recommended as a primary screening modality. When you have an ascus, it has been advised to triage with HPV test. If it is found to be infected with a high-risk HPV, then you need to follow up the patient more closely than those who are negative. Then it's used as a test of cure and test of follow-up. So HPV, the most major advantage of HPV DNA test is a self-sampling. So self-sampling can be, it can be urine, it can be vulval smears, it can be swabs, it can be vaginal tampons. This can be, it can be both patient collected as well as the healthcare providers. So this self-collection will have a great implication where there is a cultural and program barriers. So the main advantage of HPV DNA is self-sampling is no travel time. She need not travel to a health facility, no waiting time to meet a health provider, no gynec examination, no speculum examination. She is happy. And the important consideration is the health provider must have adequate knowledge to explain to the client how this technique has to be done and see that the client has understood it properly. The common approach is a woman inserts a swab into the vagina, rotates it several times and keeps it in the places it in the transport tube which has the liquid media. So this is confirmed. The self-sampling has been compared with the physician-collected samples, and it has been found it is the concordance rate is almost the same. The studies have been conducted in USA, Canada, South Africa, Uganda. The largest trial has been conducted in India. It is a randomized control study involving more than 1,31,000 people living in about 52 villages across South India between the age of 30 to 59. And there were four arms in it. One is HPV testing via, the other is cytology and the standard care. And this was a landmark publication made as early as 2009 by Professor Shankar Narayanan. And in the editorial, it has been said, from India to the world, a better way to prevent cervical cancer. And so the findings of the trial are immediate and global. International experts in cervical screening should adapt to HPV testing for widespread implementation. It is sad that the study has gone from India, but it is yet to be implemented in India. So when to start screening and when to end? Ideally, it should be started by 25 years of age. And from 25 to 49, once in 3 years. From 50 to 65, it's once in 5 years. In USA, it is a little different. It starts early because of their activities. It starts around the age, previously it was 18 years. Now it has been scaled up to 21 years. And the conventional cytology is preferred method between 21 to 65 once in 3 years. If you're going to do the co-testing, cytology plus HPV DNA, then it should be started only after 30 years of age, because before 30 years of age, most of the women would be positive for HPV DNA testing. So after between 30 to 65, it can be done once in 5 years. Now they say if you're going to screen them by HPV alone, the screening interval can be stretched up to 10 years. So this is the WHO guidelines. Twice in the lifetime, 35 and 45. And for in India, we start screening after 10 years of sexual life or 30 years of years of age. And these are the methods that are used, and vaccination. So what about the vaccinated population? They have to follow the schedule as per the continue to screen, as there is no exemption for that group, because you are able to, with quadrivalent vaccine, you are able to give protection against 6, 11, 16, and 18. In the nanovalent vaccine, you are able to give protection against 2 low risk and 7 high risk, but totally there are 14. So you are yet to cover the 7 high risk. Till then, till we have a vaccine that covers the entire spectrum, we need to continue to screen them as per their age. There is no exemption. So the very important thing is linking between the screening and treatment is very, very important. No point, only then you will be able to reduce the incidence of cervical cancer. So these are the various algorithms that are given in the WHO guidelines. So the primary via screening is the algorithm one. In the second, it is primary DNA HPV testing. Here, the DNA is screening, but only for 16 and 18. Genotyping of 16 and 18 triads is being done. This is primary cytology and colposcopic triage. Then you have primary DNA, then via triage. Then you have colposcopic triage. And then you have colposcopic triage and treatment. So this is a case study where you have a 33-year-old lady married for 14 years, positive for high-risk HPV. VIA is positive. Biopsy was CIN1. She, because she is married 14 years, we have done a biopsy. We have found a linear lesion in the anterior lip between 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock. So we offered a cryotherapy. In cryotherapy, the most important part is the lesion size should fit the probe. You get only one probe with it, without a nipple. It's a flat probe. And see here, you're able to see that the lesion is totally covered by the probe. So it's a double freeze method. Freeze for 3 minutes, thaw for 5 minutes. It was originally advocated, but now they say thaw till completely the ice gets melted and the skin and the tissues, the mucus, the epithelium turns, come back to its original color, and then do the second freeze for 3 minutes and then thaw. Originally, it was 16 minutes. Now, when you allow time, it takes around 20 to 25 minutes. So can you make out the rim of the ice ball formation beyond? Here the temperature of the probe is minus 20. And where normally we use carbon dioxide or nitrous oxide, because laparoscopy has become so rampant and practiced all over, getting carbon dioxide cylinder is not a problem. Nitrous oxide is more costlier. So this is yet another case. Mrs. R, 38 years, HPV testing done. Positive for 16, but 18 not detected. She's married for 13 years. She has 2 full-term normal deliveries. Last childbirth was 11 years and sterilization done. 2018, HPV 16 was detected. Pap smear was normal. 19, again, VAA was positive. So she had a biopsy that turned out to be chronic cervicitis. And I don't know if it was a colposcopic directed biopsy. So 2021, COVID crisis, she never came to us. 22, again, we asked her to repeat the HPV DNA. It was positive again for 16. It was a persistent 16 infection. LBC again was, impression was a LCIL. Cervix was hypertrophied with a first degree descent, old bilateral tear of the cervix present, frothy discharge present. It was adequate for visualization, type 1 TZ, large ectopia on both the lips, both metaplastic epithelium, mature and immature metaplasia present. On the posterior lip, there was a band of aceto-white area bordering the ectopia, and the sweet score was 7. And it was described as high-grade lesion. Ectocervix biopsy done. It was confirmed to be CIN2. Can you make out the frothy discharge? Can you make out the patch on the TZ right from 3 o'clock to 9 o'clock? On the posterior lip. We did a thermal ablation. This is the picture after 1 year. Coming to the video demonstration, I don't know if it will open. Let me try. So this is again a cervical lesion that was mapped with acetic acid and leucalcidin. She was 40 years, so we wanted to do a biopsy. We did a biopsy. When you do a biopsy, you have to make sure that the bleeding stops completely before you apply the thermal ablator. Sorry. Nicely plug the vagina tightly. So, and give additional pressure so that the bleeding gets sealed up. After that, wait. Then we used, previously we had the Sense cold coagulator. Now we have a handheld device. The older one is a table version, table model, where we have the console on the table and you have the handheld device. But here now it is a handheld device with the battery operated, not connected to the current. And you place it. And then you switch on the button, long press, you will see 4 lights dancing and they will come to a standstill, after which each light switches off by 5 seconds. Totally, the procedure is only 20 seconds. So, no anesthesia, it's just oral anesthesia. You keep talking for 20 seconds. Ask her how she commuted to the hospital where the children are studying and you finish the procedure. It's just 20 seconds. This is how the cervix looks at the end of the procedure. So when you have a larger lesion, we need to do multiple applications, which is only possible with thermal. Whereas it's not possible to do it with cryo. So here, but again, it has to fulfill the criteria. It should be a type 1 TZ. No suspicion of ectocervic or glandular malignancy. Patient should not be in periods, pregnant, or no evidence of PID. With only with this, you will be able to treat this. Let me show you. So this is again. The main purpose, the main aim is to treat the entire new transformation zone, even though you might have lesions at one end or at one corner, you have to treat the entire transformation zone. So the first, the lesion is mapped. You have a lesion between 1 and 2. You have a lot of tenacious mucus that has to be removed because you are not applying any force. You are only just going to touch the thermal ablator on the cervix. Whereas in cryo, once you start freezing, it gets stuck to the cervix and it will not move. But here, if there is mucus, it will keep moving. It will sliding up and down. So you must make sure that you remove the mucus completely before you apply the thermal ablator. So first the machine is switched on. You have a light source. So even if you have mapped the lesion the previous day, you can move the colposcopy away and start doing only with this. This is enough. See, the lights have now become steady. Very difficult to take pictures because they all come in the same straight line. Right. Slowly, each light gets switched off. So first, the anterior lip is treated. You are able to make out. So from there, the next application is made on the posterior. Posterior lip. You must take care that you don't involve the IUCD thread. So this is the end of the procedure. You have done two applications. Actually, there was a small lesion at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock, which that was also covered. Faint lesions. This instrument is supplied to all the district headquarters and teaching medical colleges in Tamil Nadu. One of them have completed training. And all the medical colleges are training centers. This is the picture of the cervix after the procedure. The entire transformation zone is covered. I don't know. So in cases where you have a lesion or HPV positive, but cervix looks, the os is Ali Perez was HPV positive, plus cytology says high grade, no lesions on the ectocervix, no need to do an excisional therapy in the form of LEDs. The trick of the trade is you have to move the loop very, very slowly. Once you move the loop very slowly, it won't bleed. But the bleeding spots, if they are there, can be fulgurated using the coagulation mode. And the current is set in blend to 50 watts. So, regular cervical screening and HPV vaccination. So, primary prevention along with secondary prevention only helps to reduce the risk of cervical cancer by 63%. Thank you very much for the opportunity given.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
So
yes, ma'am. Yes, madam.
Can you wind up and then?
Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Just of madam, stop.
Yes, madam. Thank you so much, madam Ramani, madam, for this wonderful lecture. It is always a pleasure listening to you, because as a student of yours, I think you will have multiple students all over the state. The person who has started the screening in the Tamil Nadu district, where Tamil Nadu state, where you could find a map in the world map. Tamil Nadu has a blue dot on the world map, mainly because of you, who started the screening program, who just trained almost all the staff nurses, all the paramedicals, doctors, and other persons started as a small project, which has increased the rate of screening. If you could see the Hindu on 29th of January, last January, you could see that the rate of cervical cancer screening in all of India is less than 1% as per the data which has been presented. But when you find out the states which have the screening program, it is found that Tamil Nadu has got 7% people screened, which is because of the intense training which you had imparted to so many people all over Tamil Nadu. You didn't stop with 1%, it was continued so much. And that has increased that India, Tamil Nadu is the only state which has got the highest rate of screening in the whole of India.
Yes,
in
yes.
fact, Kerala and Andhra have got 2 to 3%. But whereas Tamil Nadu has got 7% of the people who are screened, that is mainly because of where the interactions between the political people and other things, where NCD, though it is there, this is because of you, madam, where you have not only trained doctors, staff nurses, and you made it a point, it continues. So you are a legend, and I hope we have to pay forward whatever you have done. Paying forward is not telling thank you. We'll have to pay forward by continuing your work. I think we will continue this work. And I think this is the best thing which we could give it to you as a return.
Thank you.
Thank you, madam. It is nice that you can have always you demonstrate with videos. I think anybody who sees that will understand and will get impressed and start working towards it. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. That was wonderful. Ma'am, Ramani ma'am, thank you so much, ma'am, for the detailed presentation. And thank you, Revati ma'am and Sumati ma'am. The next session is on HPV vaccine. I invite chairpersons, Dr. Ramani ma'am and Dr. Rajeshwari, to introduce the speaker, Dr. Shanti Gunasinghe ma'am, who is the president of Chennai Menopause Society. Sahithi?
Have to stop sharing.
I should
Ramani ma'am,
yes, yes,
stop sharing the slides now, please. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
So the next Sahithi, can you please play Dr. Ramani ma'am's CV? Can you please display Ramani ma'am's CV?
Sagiti, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, then
okay.
Show CV of the chairpersons, Dr. Ramli.
I'll introduce them. Dr. Ramani, ma'am, is the National Vice President for OXI 2020, and she is international. She is one of the members of International Advisory Board, member of Fertility Society of Bangladesh, ICOG Governing Council member 2018-20, and Managing Director Ramakrishna.
Radhika, can stop, Radhika. You can stop. Okay.
And Dr. Rajeshwari is Senior Consultant in Preventive Oncologist and Colposcopy Specialist from Green Eagles Global Health City, Chennai. And she creates general cancer awareness, giving lectures, awareness sessions on cervical and breast cancer, also to adolescent and school students. And she conducts colposcopy camps and breast cancer screening camps in private clinics. And she conducts colposcopy camps for women staying in NGO homes. So can you please invite the speaker, Shanti Gunasinghe, ma'am?
Dear friends, it's nice to be a part of this very, very important webinar, and especially in the month of February, which is cancer awareness. And as all of us know, that cancer cervix is one of the commonest cancers we see among women next to the breast cancer. And it is obviously, it is a preventable one. See, for breast cancer, we don't have anything to prevent it, but only early detection is feasible. But when you look into the cancer cervix, it is highly preventable, and the vaccines are now currently available. I call upon my very dear friend, Dr. Shanti Gunasinghe, who is a consultant in OG at Mangalam Healthcare Chennai, president of Chennai Menopausal Society, past president of OXI, former director and superintendent of an institute of OBGYN, and former HOD of ONG Kilpak Medical College. She has served as a director, project director, Center for Excellence for Tubal Microsurgery, past president of Women Doctors Association of Tamil Nadu, and she has been a master trainer for BMOC, CMOC, SPA tubal surgery, lactation management and adolescent health. And she is very, very popular among the menopausal group. She has got a very keen interest on that, and as well as she conducts a lot of adolescent programs. So I think it is an ideal topic that has been given to that, because the vaccine has to be given to only during the adolescent period, because it has got the maximum potency. And we have now various types of vaccines which are bivalent, which are quadrivalent. And we should know now, we know that as per the details, even a single vaccine may be sufficient to prevent the cervical cancer. So I now call upon Dr. Shanti to deliver her lecture.
Thank you, Ramani, for your kind introduction. Can I start sharing?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Thank you, Ma. Where are you working, Radhi?
Yeah. Can I start?
Sure, go ahead, Shanti.
Yeah. So we know. So we know that HPV infection is the most common viral infection in the reproductive tract, and the infection can spread through contact with infected genitalia, mucous membrane or body fluid, that is essentially sexual contact, oral sex, and also through fomites and non-sexual contact and mother to child. So, but one thing is, although HPV infection seems ubiquitous, 70 to 90% of HPV infections are asymptomatic and resolve spontaneously within 1 to 2 years, maximum of 3 years. Persistent infection with high-risk HPV types may progress to precancerous lesion. As Dr. Ramani said, initially they were saying 100 types, now 200, even 150, certain papers quote, some quote 200, and at least 16 are oncogenic. So 5 to 10% of all infected women develop persistent infection. CIN1 can regress spontaneously, and to a certain extent, CIN2. But we understand that the interval between the acquisition of HPV infection and progression to invasive carcinoma is 15 to 20 years or longer. So that really gives us a good window to conduct appropriate screening. And we also know that every 5 minutes, nearly one patient dies of HPV-related cancer in India. Earlier, they used to say one in each. Now, with this, one in five. Human. We know the commonest cancer in women is breast cancer. The second is cervix. So, human papilloma virus-related cancers are the second most common cancer in women in India. And it is not only it is very common, India also has a higher mortality of around 60% due to HPV-related cancers compared to a global mortality rate of 50%. And so they pose a significant economic burden and a huge psychological burden. So it is not only cervical cancer, which we were talking about earlier, vaginal, vulvar, and anal too. And we also know there are a lot of risk factors for progressive HPV disease, HPV type, immune status. So especially more in women who are immunocompromised, HIV infected or receiving immunosuppressive therapy, co-infection with other sexually transmitted infections like herpes, chlamydia and gonococcal infection, young age at first pregnancy, current or recent use of hormonal contraceptives and tobacco usage. It can be smoking or it can be otherwise. So we know that HPV infection is very common, but then do we have any drugs for treating it? HPV infection can automatically with the use of body's immune system can be cleared. But otherwise, as of now, we do not have drugs. So how can we prevent HPV then? By getting HPV vaccination. It is one of the most effective form of prevention. And Bill Gates said, treatment without prevention is simply unsustainable. So mandatory to prevent cancer cervix. And not only cancer cervix, other HPV-related cancers by primary HPV vaccination. So a HPV vaccine prevents over 90% of cancers caused by HPV, prevents cervical, vaginal, vulvar cancers in women, penile cancer in men, and cancers of tonsils, base of tongue, and oropharyngeal cancer in both men and women. All of us are well aware of the WHO initiative, which is actually aimed to be achieved by the year 2030. 90% of girls to be fully vaccinated with HPV vaccine by the age of 15. 70% of women to be screened using a high performance test by the age of 35. And again, by the age of 45, 90% of to be treated appropriately. The most important thing is early vaccination is an effective key to help prevent against certain HPV-related cancers and disease. So, although our focus is on prevention of cervical cancer, we understand that as bonus, we also are protected against other HPV-related cancers and diseases. So, adolescents produce better immunity to fight HPV infection after vaccination as compared to young adults. That is the reason why we are trying to give vaccine as early as possible, and as early as 9 years. And early vaccination helps provide higher reduction in lifetime risk of cervical cancer. Louis Pasteur, who has done a lot in the prevention of infections, has said, when meditating over a disease, I never think of finding a remedy for it, but instead a means of preventing it. So how can we prevent HPV cancers? That is by primary vaccination. And HPV vaccination before HPV exposure can give better protection and effectiveness. So that is the reason why it will be more effective in sexually naive individuals. So we know that 9 to 14 years, only 2 doses, and 15 years are about 3 doses. When we give HPV vaccination prior to 15 years of age, where the immunity is really twofold than if it is after 15. So we have to really buck up and immunize all our youngsters. Vaccination of boys is also important. Males remain susceptible to HPV infection throughout their life, and HPV transmission from females to males is higher than from males to females. And males experience high rates of recurrent genital warts. And absence of routine HPV screening for males increases the risk. With so much stress on HPV screening, we still have a dismal HPV screening for females. We do not right now have HPV screening for males at all. So when was this vaccine first produced? It was, the whole process started quite early. It was licensed in 2006. And equivalent HPV vaccine, Gardasil, was the first commercially available HPV vaccine, and FDA approved it in 2006. We had the bivalent HPV vaccine, Cervarix, licensed by FDA in 2009. And Gardasil was introduced in India in 2008 and Cervarix in 2009. But the bivalent vaccine has been withdrawn in September 2020. We no longer have bivalent HPV vaccine available. We have the gender neutral for boys and girls, monovalent HPV vaccine, Gardasil 9, which was licensed in India in 2018, and Serum Institute of India launched the first made in India HPV vaccine for cervical cancer, quadrivalent Cervavac, in January 2023. In Jan 2023 itself, Indian Ministry of Health and Family Welfare started preparations for the rollout of HPV vaccine for girls aged 9 to 15 years. Yes, so on February 1, 2024, our Union Finance Minister of India announced in the interim budget inclusion of HPV vaccine for girls from 9 to 14 years universal immunization program. The tender will be called for in April 2024. So it is essentially recombinant DNA vaccine, and the quadrivalent have 6-11, which is non-oncogenic but very good for anogenital warts, and 16 and 18 oncogenic strains, which cause the majority of cervical cancer. The nonovalent has the low risk 6-11, and the high risk 16, 18, 31, 33, 45, 52, and 58. And what about the immunogenicity? Not all vaccines are 100% immunogenic, but then this is highly immunogenic and peaks antibody titers observed 4 weeks after the last dose. Titers then declined, but over the subsequent 12 to 18 months, it started stabilizing. Why can't we just wait for natural infection to occur rather than give vaccine? But we note that the serological response to vaccination is much stronger than the response after natural infection. That is the reason why HPV vaccine is recommended. And as I had said earlier, high efficacy has been observed in HPV naive population. And recent review confirmed an efficacy of over 90% against vulvar and vaginal lesions too. Quadrivalent and nonovalent vaccines provide high-level protection against anogenital warts and all precancerous lesions, susceptible tissues in both men and women. What about the duration of protection? So with a multi-dose schedule, antibodies remain high for at least 12 years for the bivalent and quadrivalent vaccines. And 6 years for the nonovalent vaccine. So as of now, once the vaccination is over, we do not repeat it at all. And how effective is it? HPV vaccination has helped reduce the risk of HPV-related genital warts and HPV-related cancers by 80 to 90%. We have a lot of studies on all these. This bivalent vaccine, which has been withdrawn, Cervarix, the Patricia trial gave 100% protection against HPV 16 and 92.3 protection against HPV 18. And Gardasil, the trial, Future 1 and Future 2. They declared that it prevented 98% of HPV 16 and HPV 18 related high-grade cervical lesions. See, if we really vaccinate start vaccinating these young girls, herd immunity will also be probably achieved, as was noticed in some countries, and decrease in the HPV prevalence among both vaccinated and non-vaccinated women. Is it really safe? People have the vaccine phobia, and HPV vaccine has helped protect lives in India over nearly 15 years. No serious vaccine-related adverse experiences have been reported. But then pain is noted. Pain at the injection site is one thing. Nearly 35 to 88% feel the pain. Redness is seen in about 5 to 40% and swelling in about 4 to 25%. Systemic adverse events like arthralgia and gastric symptoms like nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain can be seen. And syncope is not very uncommon. Earlier, the recommendation was to give it in with the client in the lying position. Now it is immunized in a sitting position. Observation for 15 minutes thereafter. It is well tolerated even by immunosuppressed, can be safely co-administered with TT, TD, TDAP or flu. Are there any obstacles to vaccination? Really we have a lot of obstacles. Cost of vaccine is one thing, and with the initiative taken by our central government, probably it will come down. Vaccine supply can be erratic. Vaccine hesitancy is always there. Now people start talking much about natural things, even for normal, even for delivery, they want at home. So all these things are due to misinformation that is always there. And the vaccine bashers, we see a group of them, especially the well-educated. And there is always a stigma associated with HPV infection. So people are a bit wary of coming and asking for HPV vaccine. Are there any contraindications? Severe allergic reaction to a vaccine component following a prior dose. So if they have immediate hypersensitivity to yeast, as in quadrivalent and nonovalent, and the precaution is moderate or severe acute illness. So you will just defer the vaccination until symptoms improve. So we already said the vaccines available in India are quadrivalent and nonovalent Gardasil, and which is for women 9 to 45 years and for boys 9 to 15. Our Foxy GCPR, the latest one, which has been released in June 2023, talks about boys being vaccinated up to 26 years. But this is what 9 to 15 years is a recommendation given by even the pharma. And quadrivalent Cervarix by Serum Institute, boys and girls 9 to 26 years. And of course, our Foxy GCPR talks up to 45 years. And vaccines to be stored at 2 to 8 degrees, administered immediately after taking out of refrigerator, 0.5 ml IM to be given at deltoid region only. So what are the special situations? It's not recommended for use in first in pregnancy. If first dose is taken before pregnancy, the remaining doses can be given post-delivery. Soon after delivery, it can be the remaining doses can be given. But if inadvertently, if it is given during pregnancy, it does not warrant the termination of pregnancy. Lactating women can receive vaccine, and postpartum women are at higher risk. So it is very, very important to at least start initiating vaccination during that period. And only 0.4% of women can be infected with all subtypes. So even if they are, it is unlikely that they are infected with all four subtypes. So at least they'll be protected against the subtypes to which they are not exposed to. So we have to take it as an opportunity to vaccinate after delivery. So testing for HPV is not recommended before vaccination. And sexually active women and women with previous abnormal cervical cytology can receive the HPV vaccine. But the benefits may be limited to the protection against infection of HPV genotypes with which they have not been infected. We should understand it is only prophylactic, not therapeutic. Women who have been infected with HPV type and have cleared the cervical infection. Earlier, they were HPV DNA positive. Now they are DNA negative. They appear to have similar protective effects as those who are naive to the same vaccine. So it is mandatory to give. This is published in our Jogi. So what about the single dose regime? The WHO Strategic Advisory Group of Experts on Immunization recommended that countries can consider either one dose or two dose regimen for girls. So one dose below the age of 14, and probably two doses after 15. Zero conversion at the end of 24 months, equivalent to multi-dose regimen. WHO also talks about the alternative single dose schedule, or an off-label option. WHO clearly states it is an off-label option in girls and boys age 9 to 20 years, one dose. And single dose vaccination regime offer program advantages, be more efficient and affordable, and contribute to improved coverage. But our drug controller of drug controller general of India, he doesn't, I mean, they have not yet approved our single dose vaccination regime. But immunocompromised HIV infected persons have to give the usual dose. So we all know 9 to 14, two doses 6 months apart, 15 to 26, and even up to 45, it is three doses. And single dose from 9 to 20 years, two doses from 21 years and above. And on February 1st, our HPV vaccine has been included in the universal immunization program. We have been late, but better late than never. Almost 140 countries globally have a national HPV vaccination program. So HPV national programs cover about 30% of global target population, significantly higher in high-income countries, more than 60% in countries like Australia, Denmark, and Sweden. So Australia has produced a lot of papers. They took it up early, and both their boys and girls are immunized by the government, and they have really brought down the incidence of cancer. There is also a paper from Scotland where they say that carcinomas have not been reported in the recent past because of the vigorous low and middle income countries remain unprotected, as only 1% of adolescent females received a full course of HPV vaccine. There is also a big divide between the urban and rural, and it's very, very important. 2% in rural and 72% in urban. So all of us should take it as our duty to really see to that they are vaccinated. So when gazing through the crystal ball, what does it hold for us? Next gen HPV vaccines, focusing on bivalent vaccines. So we have a better broad protection spectrum, and it is necessary for us to evaluate better the impact of HPV vaccination, not only on CA cervix, but on all HPV-related cancer. And therapeutic vaccines for cancer treatment are on trial. HPV type 16 E7 expressing lactobacillus based vaccine for treatment of HPV 16 positive. This is the Millikel study, and this is going on. So probably we will. Okay, so HPV, back to conclude, HPV vaccine is an effective primary prevention for cervical cancer, genital warts, and cancers of vagina, vulva, oropharynx, penis, and anus. Quadrivalent and nonovalent vaccines are available. Two doses are given in children from 9 to 14 years and three doses from the age of 15. Local reactions in the form of pain at the injection site and syncope are the common adverse effects. Single dose advocated by WHO. Quadrivalent HPV vaccine for girls from 9 to 14 years has been included in universal immunization schedule. Medical practitioners should get vaccinated, and immunogenicity is better if given early. So I thank Dr. Sampath for having given me an opportunity to share my views on HPV vaccine. And I think so much work is being done, even in FOXI, under the able guidance of Priya Ganesh Kumar, and our own TNFLG president, Revathi Janakiram, is a South Zone coordinator, and she has produced so many HPV champions. Let us all work together and really save lives.
It is simply superb. I think it has been given very clear cut what vaccine, when to give and what is the dose. And Rajeshri, you yes, can also Manavita. Add up.
Yes, it was a clear and wonderful enlightening presentation by my teacher. And in this World Cancer Day, we have all raised our voices loudly so that everybody should hear this voice, and we all should come together to take this awareness to action level. The action should be augmented and accelerated so that we all should join hands to achieve the 2030 target.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
It's nice. Nice, Shanti. Very nice.
Thank you.
Word of thanks, Radhika.
Yes, ma'am. I thank all the teachers, Dr. Revati ma'am, Sampath ma'am, Anjalakshmi ma'am, Sumati ma'am, Ramani Devi ma'am, all the teachers who have given a very dedicated their time and efforts to give the, this CME. And Dr. Rajeshwari also, who has participated in this meeting. And I thank Dr. Rishikesh Pai sir and Ashok Kumar sir who faced this occasion. And thank you so much, all the teachers and all the delegates who have been listening. And I hope all of us should be inspired and benefited by this teaching, and we will try to prevent the cancer cervix as much as possible. Thank you, Sri Priya, for helping us to organize, and Dr. and Mrs. Sahiti, to conduct this in a successful way. Thank you so much, Revati ma'am, and Sampath ma'am. Sumati ma'am, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Radhika. Thanks.